In this video lecture, we want to discuss and demonstrate how to provide external input to programs using Java's Scanner class. Okay, let's get started. We've already had a taste of using the Scanner class on an earlier program when we transformed hardwired program inputs into user inputs using the Scanner class. The Scanner class provides us with the means to accept command line keyboard inputs into our programs. This class is found in Java's java.util package, so we've already seen that it must be imported before we can use it. When we instantiate a scanner object, we provide its constructor with the input data source system.in, which is Java's designation for default keyboard input. Hopefully in a prior week you've already taken a look at this application note, User Input Using Scanner, because it nicely goes over the steps involved in using scanner. If you haven't looked over that app note, it's also included in this week's lecture materials, and I encourage you to give it a look. Just to review, there are four steps involved in using scanner. First, we have to import it using this statement, which is placed at the head of our program before our class declaration. Second, we have to declare and instantiate a scanner object. We'll see how that is done on the next slide. Third, we need to let the user know we are expecting inputs from them by providing some relevant prompt messages before each expected input. If we forget the step, it can lead us to a standoff situation where the program is waiting for the user to enter some data, but the user doesn't know they're expected to take the next step. This is a very common error when using scanner. And finally, we would use the scanner object's various next methods to read in a piece of data of some expected data type. We'll see all of these steps demonstrated in a coming example. Here's what's happening when we instantiate a new scanner object using its constructor. The constructor form that we'll be using expects some data source object of the class type InputStream. The typical default value for this is System.in, which is Java's standard designation for keyboard input. This example shows what a typical scanner instantiation looks like. Here, we are declaring a new scanner type object called scan using the above constructor. And what we're doing here is setting up a connection, or a data pipeline if you will, between keyboard input designated by system.in and this scanner input object. Once this input data pipeline is in place, and we have this one single input object named scan, we can reuse it over and over again to read single pieces of data of any data type we wish. In other words, we do not have to set up a separate scanner object for every individual piece of input data, which is another common point of confusion with new programmers. Just create one scanner object like this and simply reuse it throughout your entire program. So as always, once you have your scanner object on hand, here are some of the typical things you'll want to do with it. First, the scanner class provides these seven methods for reading the next individual token from the input stream or input data pipeline as an individual variable of the specified data type. So with these, we can read in one int variable or one double variable and so forth. You may notice that there is one method missing from this list. There is no next char method provided. So how do we read in an input char variable? We'll see how to do that in an upcoming example. It's actually quite simple. Scanner also provides these methods to read in the entire line as one big long string, or just the next token in the input stream as one individual string. As always, there are more methods than these available, so I would encourage you to have a look at the Scanner API for the full list. But the ones listed here will do most of the work we need. I'm a big advocate of the 20/80 rule. For starters, learn the 20% that will let you do 80% of what you need to do routinely, then move up from there. Scanner does its job by tokenizing an input data stream, or breaking it up into individual pieces of data called tokens, using default Java separator characters like spaces or tabs. Any given line of user input may in general contain multiple such tokens, until that input line is typically terminated by the Enter key. We saw an example of this kind of tokenizing on an earlier program involving string parsing on specific separators. The scanner object tries to read a next token of the data type it was told to look for by the current next method call. If the next piece of user input data, the next token in the input pipeline, doesn't match what the program is expecting to read next, that will lead to a program error and termination of execution. In more specific Java terms, It means that an input mismatch exception is generated and execution is halted. We haven't yet talked about what an exception means, but in layman's terms, it means that something bad or unexpected has happened in our program, and Java doesn't know what to do. Figuratively speaking, Java barfs or coughs up a lung, and you, the user or programmer, will be greeted by some seemingly cryptic error message. You may have already encountered this in some of your previous programming efforts. We'll be talking about ways to avoid this kind of problem later. One such specific situation that sometimes arises while using Scanner is that sometimes there may be some extra or residual characters in the input buffer that need to be cleared out. Sometimes, for example, a prior carriage return can cause this. To remedy this, we can simply use an extra next line call to clear the input buffer, as we'll see in the coming example. So when you're using Scanner to get data into your programs, it's important to keep in mind that neither the Scanner object nor its methods will prompt the user for whatever data is being expected. So you, the developer, must remember to always issue some clear prompt for whatever data of whatever data type is expected. If the next data entered doesn't correspond to the next method which is trying to read it, your program will crash with an input mismatch exception. But if you forget to provide the prompt entirely, a different problem happens. Your program and your user get into a standoff, where your program is waiting on some input data from the user, but the user doesn't know this and instead is waiting on the program to do something, and the program appears to be hung. This too is a very common mistake made by new programmers using Scanner. So always, always remember to provide a good user input prompt, and by that we mean several things. Always place the prompt on or near the same line as their corresponding data input. For example, system.out.println always adds an automatic new line to any printed text, but system.out.print keeps user entry on the same line. For this reason, I recommend that you use the print method, not the println method, for your user input prompts. Make the text of your prompt very clear and specific as to what data is expected. Be clear whether you're expecting textual or numeric data. If you know what data units or allowable range you're expecting, incorporate that somehow into your prompt text. Make it very obvious to your user that some data entry is expected. One good way to do this is to end your prompt text with characters such as these, and leave some trailing white space so that the blinking cursor will be more apparent. Finally, write your prompts in user-centric language, in terms of the user and not in terms of Java. Amazingly enough, most people in the world are very normal people, not programmers. So instead of prompting a user to enter a string, ask them for text instead, or ask them for a whole number instead of an int or a long. Users being users, they can still blast through and ignore the instructions and crash your program, but at least by doing such things as these, you can lessen that probability. These kinds of little details also go a long way towards making your programs more user-friendly. Here's an example of everything we've just talked about and how to use the Scanner class to get user input. I'll go through this from top to bottom in a little more detail in the code walkthrough, but I want to point out a few key things. First, notice that this import statement appears ahead of this class declaration and not inside the class. Next, notice that we set up one single Scanner object instance for all our input needs, and we reuse this same object for these five other data reads. We don't need separate scanners for each input. Notice that for these three input data prompts, we are using the print method instead of println to keep the data input adjacent to its prompt text. Here on line 38 is an example of clearing the input buffer with next line. In the prior data read on line 31, there may be a residual new line character in the input buffer, and that can mess up our next read. What we're doing here is consuming any leftover characters and simply dumping them on the ground to clear the buffer. Remember that we said that there was no next char method available? Well, here on line 44 is how we get around that in two simple steps. First, we read in the entire next line as a string, as shown here. Then we simply apply the char at method to the resulting string to peel off the first character, or char at zero. This commented out example on line 48 shows how we can do the very same thing, except this time using compound dot notation. Going from left to right in the right-hand side expression, this first part reads the input into some temporary string, then we apply the char at zero method call to that string. When all is said and done, this entire right-hand side expression evaluates to one single char, just as above. In the code walkthrough, we'll show that either way will give the same result. Finally, in terms of general coding style, notice that we have all related statements grouped together, with some white space in between for readability, and these various statement groups summarized with brief comments. This is the general good coding style I'm encouraging you to aim for in this course over the course of the semester. So please take a moment now to view the short code walkthrough video for this scannerusage.java example file. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. Understanding how this example works should give you everything you need to use Scanner in upcoming program assignments. Okay, hopefully that covers it for using Scanner for command line user input.